Now you can do whatever you want. Yeah. Yeah. Now you can do whatever you want.
He's already getting too deep for it, though.
Balloons. More balloons. I don't know my mom answered. Oops. Beautiful, beautiful decorations. The end.
I think it's
Rosemary's
Baby.
No. We'll just move it over a little. We got two. It was a special cake.
I don't think I had moved yet.
I just say, I didn't know you were a big U.S.
But I told Ayla Cleo, because I've been thinking about him a lot, and I always ask her for
something. Yeah. You got to press it, right?
Start. Yellow burn, trust the burn, huh? What else?
Megan, watch out, Freeze.
I know.
I've heard it.
Megan, Blanca, Nancy, too. Right on.
Get all the
salsa.
Nick, Yali, Cahuyo. Can you go?
Yeah.
Go film something. I'm sorry, too, okay?
No, it's okay.
Turn around, take what? Two, whatever I paid him. Cheating on him. He turned around and bought almost the same price, the newer one. You got one of the nice ones like that. It's alright, mine works good still, you know. But it just don't got the screen like this.
Here we go, pass along, say something to yourself. Here, hold on.
And he goes, I'm going over there in a half an hour, you better have every potato salad done. I was not even done cutting the pickles off.
Okay, say something to yourself.
Joanne's killing the potatoes. Birthday, oh my god, that's the best I ever made.
First of all, you need to.
What? That's everybody.
There, that's better. There, now you can see me.
That's everybody.
Oh, I'm sorry.
What's Kubi in your brain?
Right
talk later.
He's talking about when he was getting beat up. No, happy birthday, big bro. I love you. I'm having 30 for your birthday. I'm on number like 7. So I'll see you in about 23 more. I love you. Say something to your son. Happy birthday, sweetheart. I love you.
Dear mama.
Look at Miss Savvy. She's saying happy birthday.
Say happy birthday.
There's Savvy. Say happy birthday to Waco.
Oh, oh my God. Never mind. Your niece doesn't want to say happy birthday. No, I love you, babe. No. Here.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Say hi to Manuel, too.
I'll do it right now. I'm eating.
Are you all that?
He pounds with me.
I want to copy that cake, please.
Happy birthday, Ruben. Macaroni salad cake. Enjoy your Playboy scene. Enjoy your Playboy scene on this film. You'll never get another like this.
No, hey, that's neighbors.
It's recording. It is.
Robert and Alice over there.
You know what
to
do?
Huh?
We're
all doing it. I don't know if it's recording.
Oh, that's why I was confused.
Dog ran off all the tape.
I know. You know how to do it.
What? You lost two weeks of all that.
I was just doing it.
Let's go with Joe.
Hi, Ruby Doob. Happy birthday.
Shit. She'll put that corona on that throat. She'll stay up longer.
Here we go.
That's why the other kids.
One, two, three.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Ruben. Happy birthday to you.
Go Lakers!
Purple
ribbon because I know you like purple.
Is that all?
Lucky you weren't in Guam.
Come on, man.
He's ruining her.
Yeah, okay. Angela's looking at me. I can't do it.
I know.
I'm gonna get mad if I didn't do it.
Yeah. I thought it was a Hernandez party. Yeah, we're in the wrong place. Yeah. I thought you got me down. Patty, what's up?
Happy birthday, Ruben.
Yeah, I know.
And that little girl's out. She can't get up.
She's
up in the garage.
Yeah,
you
go.
Where
do
you
go?
Where
do
you go? Where do
you
go?
Where do
you go? Where do you go? Where
do you go? Where do you go?
Where do you go? Where do you go? Where do
you go? Where do you go? Where do you go? Where do you go? Where do you go?
Where do you go? Sergi's, come here, Papa. Sergio,
kind of
come here, you guys. Come in outside.
They should have cut that in half of them.
You got a little girl.
Come in with Mama. Come in out here so you don't get cut.
Rashad. Still got it wrong, sorry. Wait, where are you? Oh, there you are. Wait, there you are.
Hi, how are you?
Oh, good, good. Wait, I've got it screwed up somehow.
Am I right?
Yeah.
Now, this car will be going away. So don't waste food on you, so I have to wait back.
All of his children.
I want this picture. She's looking at her shoes.
I'm gonna go get some more.
Oh, I'm sorry. I'm sorry.
get the oxygen.
Go, Robert, go!
See the pictures?
Okay.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Oh, wait, hold on. I just have a little.
Wait, hold on. Oh, really? Are they
putting
a
ring on? Yeah.
Anyway, so I was going to say to my dad was, God, I had it memorized. Anyways,
thank you.
I love you, Dad. I had it written. Thank you for all your love and support over the years, especially the last couple of years. Little rough ones, you were there for me. Thank you. One and all, including me, all of us. Yeah. I want you to know you're a very important part of my life. And I love you. And happy birthday, many, many more. Hope all your dreams come true and your prayers are answered. Happy birthday.
Well, I just want to say, too, thank you for everybody for being here. All my friends, my family, I know a lot has happened within the last years, but this is a real special for me. I have my tia here from Guadalajara, and
I'm
grateful for that. Took a lot of effort to put this together. My wife, Yoli, did his work real hard. Trying to straighten things out between the two of us, we come into a couple of clashes and it's like, okay, well, then you do it. And I'm over here. But I mean, it's all worth it. You know, like I said, we have family here and friends. And that's real special to me. Quiero dar gracias por mi tía que está aquí también. Mi cinco años. Les doy muchas gracias. Sin su apoyo, no estuviera aquí. Gracias. Thank you. $2,000. She asked me what I wanted for my birthday. $2,000.
Monopoly money today.
This ain't had to be real, huh?
So you know I'm not going to spend it all in one place.
We have some more birthdays today, too. This month we have Ronnie, who just turned yesterday's birthday. Yay, Ronnie. And Monica's going to be 21 again.
Yay, Monica.
And Bobby is going to be 22.
Where's Bobby?
On the 25th.
Yeah, I'm finding by the beer game.
Yeah, my next birthday, I don't know, 28 tomorrow. And who else? Don't remember. Chewy had a birthday too.
Charles.
So we have a lot of birthdays.
We have a lot of birthdays in August.
We have to sing for Ronnie because he's present.
Yeah? Happy birthday,
ready,
Ronnie?
One, two, three.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Ronnie. Happy birthday to you.
Happy birthday.
Okay.
Now you
hit the music, let's dance. Okay.
Did you say something? Yes, there goes it gone again. It's a rice paper.
We just got to Yosemite Park and we came to the Sequoia National Park first, and we're gonna take a little Sequoia trip. There's some behind you right there.
Yosemite water.
Well, we got some Yosemite water because it was nice and hot out here. And there's some smelly Indian people in the market. And I almost threw up and so did Angela. She left me. As you can tell, it's a beautiful day out here. It's about, I'd say 80, but it feels nice and cool. Our bikes and our cars fill to the brim. All right, we'll see you on the trip.
These make you together. I'm gonna make sure it ends up going in our request. We'll be pausing here for just a short time. I'll give you some information and then we will be stopping back here for a bit more information and see. This looks closer. Grizzly. It has a bit of a lean to them, a 10 degrees lean, but that's okay. The root system has adapted and they're doing fine. Around the base, it's about 96 feet. You could stand 27 to 30 children around there and they would all fit. Up at the top, it is kind of short. Got struck by lightning 3 times in one day, knocking it down to, 209 feet. If you go up about halfway, on the left-hand side of that tree, you'll see a branch that looks like an elbow. Well, the bottom part of that is 6 foot in diameter, the same size as those logs that had the tannic acid on it. Or it's bigger than most of the stagecoaches and cars used to drive through there until 1932 when they put this road in over here. Now, we could safely walk through there any time you want to. Soon. So we're going to have to let them get this started and do it at their own pace. Keep the fires low. You'll look around in here, you'll see some purple bark trees. Bottom all the way to the top, you'll see it has two heads. We call this the faithful couple. They came together about 1,500 years ago.
Look at the big tree. Big tree.
So it's the oldest marriage in the world. Some people say that's because they stand their ground, don't get on each other's territory. While other people say it's because they don't talk to each other. Well, neither one of those would work at my house, but faithful couple. You get tired of looking at the faithful couple, you can look on the uphill side and see the engaged couple. In about 300 to 500 years, they too will be a faithful couple.
That's pretty cool.
Kind of have a green moss with a stump on it. What I like to look at is the root system, how they cut through by the driver's side to put this road through. If we were going to be putting this road through today, they would not allow us to cut through a root system like this. They have done lots of studies though. And they are now walking up to it. Yeah, it's been this way for quite some time. If you go from the bottom to the top, it's about 70 feet. At the base, it's about 10 foot wide. Oh, that's big enough to drive the trail through there if there was a road. But my boss refuses to let any of us go four-wheel driving.
Closed pantry. Sounds like it's very
edge.
Right.
As for the grove we were in, these branches fell from this tree a long time ago.
That's a branch.
Wow.
Right in the center, you'll notice there is a scar. They tell me 100 years ago that was 3 foot wide. As you take a look around, you can find an average size square. You see if it was good for lumber. You can cut it down and build 43 bedroom homes. It's just not good for lumber. Over here on the passenger side, we have a group of trees called the Seven Sisters. Given enough time, it's going to be 1, 2, 3. All those days. inside the trim. You would not want to have to replace anything or move. Coming up on the driver's side is the Abraham Lincoln Street. And the George Washington Street is behind it.
Ow.
I get that on film.
I'd like to tell you a story about Galen Clark, a very young man then, when I want to tell you the story. Only in his 40s, it was 1850. He wanted to come to California and try to get rich in the gold rush. Well, he came here for a little while and he got a bad cough. Went to the doctor and the doctor said, I'm sorry, sir, you have 6 months to live. Consumption is what you have. Consumption is what we now know as tuberculosis. So he moved 6 miles down the road to Wawona, dug a grave, carved a tombstone, and waited to die. As he waited, though, he got to feeling pretty good. Got on a George road up here, saw these trees. Well, he fell in love with Lord Jesus, so Silver Street is coming down today. Anyone from those places? No? Well, this next tree hands down the most famous all over the world. Even today, on a postcard. Stagecoaches and cars used to drive through right here until the winter of 68-69. And when they changed its name from Wawona Tunnel Tree to the Fallen Tunnel Tree. When they came up here to plow it away, the snow away, it had twisted and turned and had fallen down. Right in the center, though, you could see there's a flat piece. That was part of the tunnel. The tunnel was 26 foot long, 8 foot high, and 10 foot wide. Climbed about 1,000 feet in elevation. And if you look around, you can see the stars on these trees. Well, that's why they suppressed all fires when they first came here, thinking it would help it. Since they drink so much water a day, it's like having 2 foot of wet newspaper all around the base. When Galen Clark came and he named it the telescope tree. You do have the right to come back up here, walk back up here when we get to the museum, and check it out. If you stand inside of it, even today, you can see the sky.
Oh, that's cool.
The telescope tree. Even though it's burnt all the way through, it is a living tree. Now have a natural cave, and they tell you any winter you want to, you can find a bear hibernating. But he's already out looking for the bear necessities. Well, you can walk down from here, 2 miles, take you a little over an hour to do so, and walk back up and see any of the other trees that we're seeing. The weather.
Thank you.
here is the Philadelphia tree. And the second one here is the St. Louis tree.
You think she's making that stuff up?
Yeah.
That's all.
This tree right
that's Oxnard
here
tree.
Dedicated to all the unknown soldiers of World War I on the passenger side.
So to the unknown dead of World War I.
I want you guys to look over here on the driver's side.
Oh, look, Ange.
We have some
right
deer.
The deer, see?
They're both setting down.
Both? I don't see them both.
One is over by this tree, and the other one is... This is the first deer that I've seen today.
I don't know.
We have a buck and a doe.
Oh yeah, it's centipede.
Oh, I see his ears wiggling.
I was just fixing to say we have black bears and we have deer, and I always look over on this side when I start to say that. Amazing, huh? We also have mountain lions. We have coyotes and foxes. Wolves. We have raccoons, possums, squirrels, chickarees, chipmunks, bats, gophers, snakes, skunks. We have lots of birds. Haven't seen a lot today. Everybody's been asking me where they are. And we have butterflies. Mariposa means butterfly. Okay, one more picture. Our buck is about 3 years of age. Sometimes they don't. Okay, we'll get on down and see if we could.
Hey Angela, could you tell me about your experience with the tram? Okay.
She's a crazy driver.
Yes, she's crazy. She's fast. The road is bumpy. My arm almost got taken off like the little squirrel. Right there. Oh, it took off. All right, we're gonna go see the what's it called? Tunnel tree. Hey, record. My pants are falling down.
Oh, whoa. Alright.
Wait.
Go hurry up, we only got 5 minutes. Go look. Go look, dude. Stand by yours.
Hey, Dylan, look,
Noah. Come on. They're just taking pictures. Exactly. Let's go see the grizzly tree real fast. Ange, let's see if we see ESP and Soila and Stomper. Oh, sorry, man. All right, we just left the big trees. We're both feeling nauseous because it's stupid they didn't know how to drive. Again, Chapco. And we're coming up to Yosemite Valley. We're about to get to the tunnel. There's Half Dome, as you can see. We're both hungry.
Mm.
Thirsty.
Amen.
Sleepy.
Amen.
But we're gonna make it. So we're gonna videotape the tunnel right now, and then you'll be able to see all of Yosemite Valley. It's about 4 o'clock right now on Sunday.
Writing career when she'd been their primary breadwinner.
It's trippy.
What's up?
This one's trippy.
We're now inside the tunnel. That leads into not that much, huh?
Where is it?
Over there, see it?
No. Oh, yeah. It's like a little water there.
So what do you think, Lee?
Battery's running out. How are we gonna charge it?
See if there's any people on there.
What?
I'm seeing if there's any people on there.
You can't even see in the picture. It's making me dizzy. Ruben, be careful. He's gonna buck you. Hi, Michaela.
Michaela, to your room. Last picture.
Let me find that good one.
We can get through here and just keep a safe distance from the deer. We sure appreciate that, okay?
Okay.
You guys, everyone hear that down there? Yeah, yellow line? Thank you.
Yeah, and where the deer cross the road.
Get the one with a nice rack.
Their antlers look furry, huh? That's a good idea.
Careful,
Angie, go pet one. Go pet one, Angie. Go jump on one.
Show your finger. Give me the finger.
Oh, yeah. Today is Monday. This is Patsy's finger.
This is better than that one we saw last night. Oh, yeah. Itself.
Okay. Matt, look at me. Look at me.
Come on, let's go look at these. Me and Scott went to go get firewood right now. And we noticed that all these deer are out here. So we went and got Patsy and Angela and Michaela. And now we're here looking at them. Mm-hmm. That's a good idea, honk the horn, dummy.
Yeah.
This is the dumbass that honked the horn right now.
Get half them.
Oh, yeah.
Good idea, Lee. That's half dome.
One's coming up here.
That's Mount Washington. Don't be trying to trick me, right? That's North Dome. And where's, we're camping in there, right there. Thank you, thank you. That's where we're camping, over there somewhere. We can kind of see the camp around.
Oh my gosh. Look at these right there, Rick.
You can't go beyond the AFL.
That must have been some weird growth on his, too.
You know, I don't know.
For flowers. I know, he's like, take a picture, why don't you? It'll last longer.
He's looking up. All right, guys, take some pictures so you can.
You took pictures of him?
Yeah. You can take another picture of these, just real close looking. Yes, Freak. What's that up there, Lee? Called?
Over there?
What's that up there, Scott?
Glacier Point.
Oh, yeah, Glacier Point. Huh? When you go up there to Glacier Point, there's some pictures of people standing right there at that edge.
You might be able to get them. See if you can get that close.
Get that up there?
Yeah. This thing does do a 10 zoom. Or 40 zoom, or 220 or something, I don't know. Oh, dang.
Oh, my God. Watch out, the car. The car.
The guy didn't see him, or what?
I don't know.
This was filming a dummy.
Yeah, I'm filming another.
He's going to get caught.
Yeah. Right, the deer cross the road.
Get to the other side. Oh, my God.
They did a deer crossing sign.
You got it. Oh my God.
Where's the rest of the family?
Uh-oh. Where's the race?
Is it in the red truck? Yeah, I got the right of way.
I know. There's no crossroads here. Is he going to jump over, Lee?
He ate too much. He's thinking. Here they come. Look at the rest of them.
Oh, wow. Look at that.
I thought the sign was lying.
Oh, they are. Look at
that. What a trip.
Oh, my God. Oh, my God. Oh, my God. Oh my God, they're all coming.
Look at the little baby one.
He's the head honcho. Yeah. Oh. 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 What happened? Whoa. Who's that?
The other one startled him.
Hold on. Hold on. It's your call. Look at him. He just keeps licking himself. He doesn't care. Let them go without me.
He's a rebel. This guy has his camera ready.
Yeah.
That's what man's guys are saying, damn, we don't have our cameras.
That's awesome.
He'll cross the street. Some guy just crossed right over and parked the other way around to get off.
I can't believe that dumb caravan is just,
you know.
Yeah.
Foreigners.
Oh, is that what it was?
Wow, it's so scary.
Where's the other one? He just jumped. No, yeah, all right, more from me.
He's looking at me. Oh, yeah.
Go ahead, I'll catch up.
I know. Uh-oh, here he comes. Yeah.
Wait.
We're like, hold on.
And then they cross so slow.
This is their world. I know. I need to clock in. Oh yeah, what's your friend? Dude, why Zoom Lee?
Oh yeah.
The other way. Like up and down. Yeah, that way.
Look at the mom's yelling.
Oh, the other one's way over there.
There's 11.
I heard another person.
I think that's kind of true of all males. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8.
You see it?
Yeah, it's over there. It's down.
Where? Oh, yeah, I see it.
It's the one that we first started taking pictures of.
Watch out, Michaela.
Side, you want to cross over?
Yeah, come on.
Oh.
So what do you think, Lee?
Awesome,
man.
That's
coming out.
That's
all right. There's one lone survivor.
Oh, yeah. You know what? Will you guys, you know what, Scott? See if they could take a picture of us with that behind us.
Okay.
Take a picture of that.
This is the Kershaw family with Half Dome behind them.
Can you do up and down?
Yeah, that's better. Okay, 1, 2, 3.
Yeah, come on.
Okay, you guys know. That's Still Glacier Point right there. And right there is where a piece of rock fell off last year and killed somebody.
Stay right there. Pat.
This is Angela and Patsy
talking
crap about my narrating. This is your Angela's narrating. Go ahead. You're on.
I already took it.
Just take in the scenery. You don't need to get on. Don't get a close up.
Here, let me take the lead. You and the catcher. You take a picture.
They're going to take a look, dummy.
Watch your finger. Get up. Come on, because the one if it comes out,
good. I'm gonna open the office.
Well, Michaela looks too stiff. Relax.
I can't open it.
Don't touch my finger.
I don't see nobody on Half Dome.
That's an incredible picture.
It is pretty cool.
I should paint that and sell it.
Yeah, it'd be
cool. This is cool.
It was, it's cool. There they go. Where's that last one, Kim?
The
last one's still over. Is that other one still over? Oh, no.
Did he cross? Did he cross over from the other side?
No. If he did, we will see him.
Well, they're not in a real hurry.
Mm-mm.
We can still catch him. See, there's the Royal Arches. Right there, see?
Where?
See how you have to go like that? The cutouts in the wall?
Oh, yeah.
That's the Royal Arches. That's North Dome. That's Washington Monument.
Where's Washington, whatever it's called?
Washington Column.
Washington Column, North Dome, Half Dome,
Royal
Point.
No, this is good. Mm-hmm. Okay. We're right underneath it.
Where's those falls at? Can you see them from here?
It's Simony's right there. Can you see the broken arrow right there?
Oh, yeah.
That's Lost Arrow.
That little
point right there is Lost Arrow. There's postcards of guys hooking it right there and right there. And they hook a rope together and they just kind of like rappel down. Looks pretty crazy. And that's where the waterfall usually is, but it's late August and there's no water left. I want to get this just for $10,000, just in case.
It's probably the husband.
I got one that was just the side of it. It would have been cool to space in it.
I'm crossing. It. Back. It's
awesome. My battery's going to leak.
Some of our pictures,
mm-hmm.
Some of our pictures, we could enlarge them ourselves and frame them.
Yeah, they're much bigger.
Gives me chills.
And get my binoculars out of the car. Yeah. In the, right in the front seat.
You can recharge your battery though, right?
In the bathroom. I just have to sit in there for a while.
Some lady was doing that. Where was?
In the backpack, love.
What are you looking for?
All right. We left Yosemite this morning about what time, Ange? 11:30.
Yes.
And just a second ago, it was nice and sunny. But as we drove across the street from our hotel, this fog, or whatever you want to call it, came in. So now it's not sunny no more. But anyway, we're all showered and clean. We needed the shower, because Angela smelled. So we're at the beach now in, what's the city called, Ange?
Cambria.
Cambria. We're just down the street from Hearst Cats, so where we're gonna go tomorrow. Anyway, this is Cambria. Trails is closed. Yesterday we went up to what's it called? Glacier Point in Yosemite, but our battery was out, so we couldn't bring the video camera. The trail. It's real windy now too. I don't know what happened. Imagine. All right, we just got here to Hearst Castle. We're on tour number 3 because tour 2 was booked until later. So we're starting with tour 3. We've done tour 1 before, so that's where we're starting with 2.
Now it's really very,
that's Cindy Lee, our tour guide.
And so this one is the largest. It's 104 feet long, about 58 feet wide. The alcove over here, another 20 feet back. It's 3.5 feet shallow at the other end, although it's 10 feet deep at this end. Looks to me like it's perfectly flat, but it's not. Later on, when we're in the Roman pool, the indoor pool, it is definitely a 10-foot flat bottom pool. And yet it will look like it has a curve to it. So the architect here is sort of playing with our senses. It took hers 12 years to get it to look this way. It's a combination of old... Yeah, the temple facade over there, Mr. Hurst bought on the open art market. The granite columns, the marble entablature, and the pediment up on top all date from the 1st to the 4th century AD, making these 1,600 to 2,000 years old. And then he hands them to Julia Morgan like a jigsaw puzzle, saying, here, do something nice with them. And essentially she does, only having to design it. She has a challenge, however, and that's that those columns are all different fragments and different pieces, so the pedestals on the bottom have to be adjusted in order to make it all square. And Neptune is the gentleman that's in the center there in the pediment, almost looking too big for the triangular space there, and he is the god of the sea. The Roman name Neptune, the Greek name Poseidon. And so here he is ruling over his pool. Questions about
it? Is it okay to take
sure. Oh no, you can't use flash up here at all. No, outside.
We had to replace some of them, and you'll be able to see every once in a while over there where some have been replaced. They'll look newer.
What's that, Liv?
And that's because we put 30 million visitors through here in 42 years. Mr. Hurst planned for finish logical again. Medium size one, the second one to be finished, 3,500 square feet, 18 rooms. And then the smallest one right here, 2,600 square feet. Mr. Hurst and Julia Morgan always referred to these as little houses, and yet they're bigger than most homes we live in today. Mm-hmm. But Mr. Hurst said, so you decide to make this a Mediterranean village on a hilltop, and then you have to decide what kind of architectural style you're going to use. And there was some debate. Mr. Hurst wanted something with far more flourishes on it. Julia Morgan said it won't work with a few number of buildings. And they settle on this, Mediterranean Revival, which is the same as Renaissance Revival, except it's focusing on the Mediterranean area, Italy, southern Spain. Creamy colored walls, white, red tiled roofs. Some carvings made out of cast stone, lots of cherubs. You're going to see lots of tile work. All of this designed by Julia Morgan, fired at the California Fans Company in Berkeley. Fancy grill work on the windows. What do we think of when we see this? Security. But it's not. This is considered decoration on a house that has plain white walls. Then you throw into the mix some bougainvillea. And from time to time, you get what you have today. Just a wonderful display of color. Well, let's go on inside and see what Mediterranean Revival looks like inside. Under restoration. Two bedrooms and two bathrooms, and they're redoing the gold leaf that you see up here on these ceilings. Now, these ceilings were done by craftsmen here on the hilltop. They're made out of cast plaster, painted and gilded, and that is 23 and 3/4 or 24 karat gold. And nothing lasts forever, and so these ceilings that you see here could be almost 75 to 80 years old. And so they're having to go in and redo it. Here is a perfect example of what's happening. You see this lamb right here, where you can see some of the cast plaster coming through. And that's what they're taking care of. What we're going to see here and what is typical of the guest cottages is they usually on one floor will have four bedrooms, four bathrooms, and a sitting room. This is the sitting room, and we don't have sitting rooms in our homes anymore, do we? But we do have living rooms and family rooms. And so this is like a living room. This is a place for conversation. So if you were staying in any one of these four bedrooms, everyone would use this sitting area in common. 10 or 20 guests here at a time. Mr. Hurst is not entertaining on a normal basis large numbers of people here. This is his country home, small, intimate entertaining. And there are bison, all kinds of zebra and goats and sheep and kangaroos, llamas, you know. And they had the right of way. Large signs saying caution animals, and they had the right of way. Now, what I'm saying, I have to slow down just a bit, okay? The bed that you see here is a 16th century bed made out of wood, carved to replicate folds of fabric, tassels, and fringe. And it was called the Cardinal Richelieu bed, but this never belonged to Cardinal Richelieu. It was one of the richest miss up here on the hilltop. Actually, we think it belonged to the Balbi family. You see these three fish right here? That is the crest for the Balbi family. Now, I don't know much about the Balbi family, but I think I can surmise two things. They were probably fishermen, and they were very wealthy and successful to have a bed like this. Now, as you look at the bathrooms here, you'll see white tiled bathrooms and showers. Showers were almost unheard of in that time period. Some people who came to stay here said they had never, also that we can run tours through here. They were totally private.
I filmed them. No, it's okay. I was. I know.
Sitting rooms, a very large kitchen. It is the only kitchen on the hilltop. Everyone expected to come here to have their meals in the only dining room on the kitchen, called the refectory. We show that on tour one. Construction material is reinforced concrete. And up here, where the teakwood cornice is, behind there, Mr. Hurst's private suite of rooms, his bedroom, Marion Davies' bedroom, and that's his sitting room, which was considered to be his primary residence from 1928 until 1940. Once World War II started, he left here, and he went to Wintoon, which is in Northern California, up by Mount Shasta, off the McLeod River. That was his Bavarian estate. I guess I should tell you, this is only one of seven homes Mr. Hurst owned of this size. It's not his biggest ranch, although he owned 250,000 acres, not his biggest ranch. His biggest ranch was in Chihuahua, Mexico. 1 million acres. This is one-fourth the size. It's my understanding that when you hit the gate in Chihuahua, a museum. He said, in 1927, I want this place to be a museum of the finest quality things I can buy. He used to invite...
Sorry.
What?
Folks, can you just keep moving in and squeeze up a little bit first? Yeah, I know. Have you ever known anybody that buys ceilings? But you bought them on the open art market. Most everything that you see here was purchased through New York auction houses. In fact, the next ceiling was not. It was obtained by some Arthur and Mildred Stapley Bynum. Let's go on in there and talk about that in that room.
So the architect wants to design the entire house?
No, and that was the other thing that we'll talk about. Because what comes first, the chicken or the egg, right?
Whatever.
This large, massive sitting room was yours and yours alone if you stayed in that other room there. And I'm sorry, I'm going to have walk in front of you so you get everybody in here. This ceiling up here that you see, which looks very different, this is a exposed beam ceiling. And it's from the 15th century. It's been renovated. Again, you see this painting on here, black, gold, and red paint. And this was found by Arthur and Mildred Stapley Bynum. They were renowned dealers in Spanish antiquities in Spain, looking for objects for Mr. Hearst and other people. So he had them looking for ceilings for him. He was getting catalogs shipped to him on a regular basis from Sotheby's, Park Bernay, etc. I get L.L. Bean and Land's End catalogs ad nauseum all the time, but Mr. Hearst, different level, but that's how he used to do it. Sometimes he would attend auctions himself. Got to be known as the kind of guy that would pay whatever necessary if he wanted an object. He didn't set a limit. He would, and if some state of California cut a hole through the wall in order to run the tour.
We're on the second floor of the Hearst Castle.
Keep moving forward. For those of you that are taking pictures, remember there's 11 people in the group. Now this ceiling here is a 16th century ceiling, and what's rare about it is it's wood and tile. And these are Cuenca tiles, which means that there's a ridge between the colors so that when they're fired, the colors don't run together. And this is also unusual in that most pine Spanish ceilings are not carved, and this one is. And you can see what happened to it. Yeah. It's drying out.
Yeah.
Anyway, this ceiling was so valuable that we've seen so far. I want to introduce you to marble. Shower back into the wall over here, a black porcelain tub, toilet, and pedestal sink, gold-plated fixtures. And as we move and look at bathroom to bathroom, be sure to look at them. You'll see a different marble used in every single bathroom. Here we're going to be walking through two closets lined with cedar.
You just go up and over.
Thank you. Mr. Hurst a religious man? I think you're asking me that because of all the religious art that you see. His art collection has absolutely nothing to do with his religious convictions. He was Episcopalian. He wasn't necessarily religious because he didn't go to church on Sunday. But you build a medal during that period of time. Here you have hanging on the wall a cape. Compare and contrast that to this over here, which is a cope. It's straight across. If you love to collect textiles, some of the best are going to come from garments used by priests in church. Let's head on into this other large sitting room here. This is the ceiling I was telling you about, folks, that does support your
eyes. Yeah.
To make the fourth floor his final residence for he and his companion Marion Davies, Julia Morgan, instead of ripping this out, subsumes it and builds on top of it. You'll see we're going to go up some stairs to the fourth floor in just a few minutes that are very steep, and that's why. 16th century ceiling, Spanish ceiling, even though it has Greek symbols on it for Christ and Jesus. Now, style changes occur between the 28-year construction period, but more than that has gone on. In 1919, when Hurst began construction up here on the hill, he is at the apex of his career. All of his newspapers, magazines, movies, making tons of money. He inherits the entire family fortune. The sky's the limit. He's collecting a lot, building all, you know, the clear horizon. But by the time he starts decorating these rooms here, he's in his late $126 million in debt. And part of the financial reversal that he had was to turn over his finances to a friend. Let's head on up. You deserve a break anyway. You climbed up all those stairs.
I'm going to get a picture of it. Stop me. We just watched a short video about Mr. Hurst.
About it, he starts a rather ambitious project late in life at 56, and he begins building this house. I don't know that he ever intended it to be a 28-year construction project, but that's what it ended up being. Up above, you see a ceiling called the Media de Naranja. That's half orange in Spanish. That's, of course, the dome part here. All the La Serrilla work around the outside done by the craftsmen to make it fit into the space. So when Mr. Hurst returns here in 1945, he decides to make this house here, this floor rather, the final residence for he and Marion Davies, his companion that he lived with openly for over 28 years. And this would have been Marion Davies' bedroom. The room that we were sitting in for the movie would have belonged to her maid, and that bathroom off of there would have belonged to her maid. This bathroom here, however, would have been for Hurst and Marion to use. We affectionately call it the Long John.
Yeah, this is her walking closet. This is her bathroom. I don't know. I know what you call it, a long john.
That's right. would have been Mr. Hirsch's study had he been able to live here, and he needed a place to work. By some accounts, working as many as 18 hours a day, sleeping very little. And this is almost a duplicate of what his study looks like on the third floor suite in Casa Grande, except this is about one-third the size of that one. Here you see those same cement load-bearing arches, and these are painted by the same artist, Camille Salon. These are English folk tales. And from here at his desk, he could do business, running 96 businesses here from the Hilltop, mostly by telephone, telegram, and telegraph. And here's one of those phones. Had a 24-hour-a-day switchboard. And Calvin Coolidge visited here in 1930 with his wife, Grace, who's the ex-president of the United States. He said that the communication system here on the Hilltop was far more sophisticated. So here's a guy that liked being surrounded with nothing younger than the Renaissance in his art collecting, and yet he loved technology. What do you think? Okay, let's head on down this way, and I'll show you what would have been his bedroom.
We're going to his bedroom. You don't see the pools, or, well, the indoor pool. Kind of a simple room, huh?
Cool. Yeah, a huge lifespan. But it was right over here. The buildings around the trees, but they finally got to a point back here where there were at least four that they had to move. So the grand ballroom would have connected the new wing here to your right with the south wing down there to your left. South wing started in 1927 in order to house the service.
Also, this is the quarters for the servants.
Also, remember, we're doing tours here. We're putting 4,000 people. That's where I'm taking you now.
So the tennis courts.
About to go into the Olympic size indoor pool.
I'm back on my drum.
Yeah, this project is really
install all of the tiles here, making this these mosaics on the outside. He saw something in
Italy. Are you sure? The tennis courts are up there. This whole pool is 10 feet deep, and over there is only 4 feet deep. I know.
And you're just being brought along by her who's been here on tour one and what she wants to do two, two, because,
right.
Okay, gotcha.
Okay. Peeked under the lid, but they say he's not here anymore.
What is Hearst doing with an 1800-year-old Roman coffin in his garden? I think the idea is, got your Renaissance.
So what did you do 400 years ago for antiques in the garden? You could find some, you had some Roman antiques laying around. So Hearst is doing that, you know, different time levels here, and that's why he's got a couple of these. This is probably, like I said, second or third century piece, so 1800 year old piece. Now the one up here looks like a sarcophagus. Hearst bought it as a sarcophagus. It's probably a 100-year-old plate. There was a building in Spain, southwest of Spain, that had a cornice like that, made out of pine wood that Hearst admired. So, couldn't buy it. Got back to California and told his architect what he wanted to do. So, Julia Morgan hunted up some teak wood that was available in the Bay Area. The carver she wanted to use was a Swiss immigrant who didn't want to come down here to do the carving. So they wound up sending him these big, huge blocks of teak wood. He carved the figures, they shipped them down here, and just put them up there over a period of time. Here's another one, right? Hearst buys this as a sarcophagus. Antiquities experts say it's probably a 100-year-old fake sarcophagus, right? You buy a big block of marble, you carve it to look ancient Roman, and sell it to the wealthy Americans, huh? And boom.
bone. That's what apparently happens.
Whose bones are those?
I don't think this one ever had a dead Roman. This is probably the fake.
Let me take you out. Last person is going to go the old Spanish door on.
This is the after lunch huffing and puffing I'm doing here, huh? The bedroom suite that we're going to go into has sort of an Italian flair, and I'll show you some of those pieces as we get there. He's got this little alcove, right? That he's got some Spanish things he can use. This wrought iron gate here is 16th century Spanish. The wall hanging is 17th century Spanish. And with that yellow light, this looks gold. It's not gold, it's silver, huh? It's silver over a wooden base.
Up there too.
I'll show you his bedroom that he used a lot back in the 20s and 30s. And we'll get up there on the third floor. He did use it. Just be careful to stay on the great tour mat if you would. We probably should start with the ceiling. Huh? 18th century Italian ceiling here, with some plaster or wood extension work so that it can fit the room. Okay, the bed is probably Italian, about the same era, a little bit earlier. 400-year-old chest of drawers over here is also Italian, okay? So you got some Italian pieces. While we're looking over here, Chinese lamps, German candle holders, French chasubles, Dutch painting, Persian carpet, stuffed chair from Barker Brothers of Los Angeles. Right, this guy's a Californian, right? We're in America, and he was when he's collecting artwork and decorative arts, he's not paying much attention to the art experts. Okay, again, he's your age when he finishes his big 18-month tour of Europe. This piece here.
Oh wow!
Yeah. Uh-huh. Oh, all of it's his. This is pretty much the way the house was in the 30s. Step on it. Come over here so you can see this piece. We'll talk about that. I usually don't talk about that, but we think this is. I'll make sure you stay on the gray tour mat so we don't set off alarms here. We think this is from the Gian Lorenzo Bernini workshop in Italy. He was a real influential designer of the 1600s. Can you see what's going on in this piece? This is a Baroque piece. Let me get over here. Right. This is from the 1600s, this Baroque style. It's almost like sports photography, right? So what she's doing, this is the moment that she's turning into a tree rather than being his girlfriend. So that's what's happening. But this is the moment of action. You see her fingers are turning into leaves and stuff up there. Huh? Nice old piece from the Bernini workshop. I should say, yeah. Paintings are from Venice, Italy, the 1500s. And see the little window technique? This is a real common Renaissance thing to do back in the 1500s. Does two things for you. It gives a little depth to the picture. And then what you do, I don't know if you can see this from the glare. I'll tell you, that upper left-hand corner has a little battle scene. And this guy's a military officer. So you do one of his battles that he was in. Right? As sort of, you do a little resume thing here. We don't know who this guy is, right? All we know the painting was painted in Venice, Italy in 1558, and that man was 28 years old, but we don't know who he is, right? But look at the window. It's either a factory or a warehouse and a boat on the river. Of a guy named Stanford White. Anybody know that name? 100 years ago on the East Coast, he was very influential. Architect, trendsetter. He was sort of the Martha Stewart of the East Coast 100 years ago. He was murdered at Madison Square Garden by the jealous husband of his former girlfriend, shot there while he was dining. And because he was such a big influential figure, the next year they just sold off his whole house. People just walked through his house and bid on things. So the weather vanes on the bell towers were
part of the Stanford White collection and this ceiling. Hearst bought it, put it in storage for 12 years, and then boom, there it is. But I mean, how do you get stuff like this, right? Always has rather complicated stories.
The other side of these curtains, just regular
concrete walls, you bet. That's why there's lots of fabric, right? Because the whole house is reinforced concrete. So everywhere you can, you're throwing up either some ornately carved wood or some fabric. Notice, too, don't miss this one, telephone on the table, huh? 80 telephone lines on the hilltop. He had his own telephone operators. He had telegraph and teletype. So the guy's really well wired for the 30s, huh? Matching bedroom over here. Any of you watch Turner Classic Movies, old movie fans here, anybody? No? Van Johnson, anybody remember Van Johnson? Van Johnson's birthday today, by the way. He would have been, 85 years old today. He was a guest in this suite here back in the 40s. But notice the ceiling, right? It's the same as the other room. So what you're doing is this Renaissance thing where things balance. So you use the other half of the ceiling and the matching 17th century Spanish door. Right, this bathroom's got one and the other bathroom had one. 300 years ago, these were closet doors in a church in Spain. Right, so you buy them, split them up, and have your bathrooms match. Let me take you up to the library. There's windows here. The windows were put up. These are reproductions of the windows that were put up in the late 1920s, 27 or 28. We are facing almost due south here, okay? And when we get winter storms in this area, the weather front comes out of Alaska, but the wind will blow from the south, okay? So they had this as an open corridor until the other people were walking by here. Typewriter in that room. 300-year-old Spanish Vargueño, a drop-leaf writing desk, and this one, there were lots of writers as guests here. Okay, Amelia Earhart. Not a bad view of San Simeon, is that?
Let me talk about
the ceiling in the library.
Notice the box, the plastic box behind the little lectern there, the antique Italian piece. The plastic box on the other side has two needles that are measuring the humidity and the temperature in the room. So when you have a lot of old fabric, you don't want the humidity to get too high. And upstairs, next floor up, there are a number of old paintings. You don't want the humidity to get too low and dry out and crack your old painting. So that's why they close up the house sometimes. It's a little bit stuffy. Ceilings. Young lady was thinking, this is a pretty odd-looking ceiling. It's 16th century Spanish, out of pine. So it's about 400 years old. It's 2 feet thick. Okay, it's called a coffered ceiling. That's what those wells are. Hearst's private level is the next floor up, okay? And this was not just the library. Harpo Marx If you remember Harpo, the Marx Brothers, he was a guest here. He talked about... She gives him the oldest painting in the house. She lends him $1 million in the late 30s when he has a little cash flow problem. It's a nice friend. Mm-hmm. Nice friend. And she wasn't poor either. You know, Phoebe Hearst is the woman that takes him on the big art tour of Europe. That's his mom. She was also the co-founder of the Parent Teacher Association in 1897, the PTA, and the first woman to be a regent of the University of California. She got the money when George died. When she married George in 1862, this is her as a younger woman. I mean, she wasn't in that nice dress. She was in a homespun wool dress when they got married in Missouri. But the day before the wedding, this is June of 1862 we're talking about here, Missouri, she goes to the county courthouse with George and has a prenuptial agreement certified by the county clerk, right? 19-year-old rural Missouri girl, when she's going to get 50 shares of his mining stock no matter what happens to the marriage, okay? He's 41. She's 19. He had wooed her mother 20 years earlier.
I am, though.
See, when you have paintings from the 1490s, right, you don't want to get them too dry, and then when you have fabric that's 400 years old, you don't want it to get too damp and destroy it. So that's where that 50% part is. I think he bought it that way, though.
Yeah.
Just go ahead and walk on in.
Yeah, iron.
Oil lamps that were electrified. I don't know if they were electrified before or after.
They were in church then before, or?
Quite possible. Anybody ever take this tour before? Tour two before? This was Marion's bed. It was put back here last September, right? Marion Davies was the other woman. So Hearst dies in August of 51 down in her house in Beverly Hills. The five sons are loyal to mother, right? So her stuff was out of here, right? This is not her dress, right? This is of the era. The little slip. Did anybody see the little red slippers in the closet? The WRH on the toe. Those were his bedroom slippers, his neckties, and his hats. This is not her stuff, right? She's the other woman. So her stuff was out of here. It was only last year that we put her bed back in here. There were twin beds in here for years and years and years. She thought, Marion Davies thought, that when the deal was done in 57, the agreement says something about, you need to show the house the way we give it to you, basically. I guess it was phrased loosely enough that because his elves were in the house, we knew this was the bed that we could take the twins out.
How many of your sons are still alive?
Watch your step, she said. Oh, shit. Damn, this is bad.
Study. And we've got about 3,700 books in here. A portrait of hers done in 1894 by a childhood friend, a guy named Orrin Peck. On the other side of the wall was her private office. Okay, so this was his Gothic study. This is where he meets with the publishers, the editors, and you know, and most all of you have done tour one. You saw, you know, people getting ready to go swimming and the horseback riding and the tennis playing. Lots of power swirling here. You had Louis B. Mayer, you had Sam Goldwyn, you had Jack Warner, you had Walt Disney as guests here. You had, at different times, Calvin Coolidge. You had Joseph Kennedy, right, the father of the future president, was here in the spring of 1932 talking William Randolph Hearst into supporting Franklin Roosevelt for the Democratic nomination. Okay, so some heavyweight politics from time to time, along with the editorial business and, you know, the graphics of the newspaper and whatever else. You know, A.P. Giannini, anybody know that name? He was the founder of Bank of Italy that became the Bank of America. He was up here, helped Hearst sort of restructure his finances in the late 30s. So. Tower. And then Hearst just decides, you know, seriously, rainy day, could use a couple extra bedrooms in the main house, move the bells up, turn this into a guest bedroom. That's where we're going. That's about fourth floor guest bedroom. Oh. Why the narrow doors, right? He's a huge guy. He just finds a nice old 400-year-old Italian door that he likes, you know, and you need to make it work here. That's the deal. We're in the fourth floor of the South Tower, okay? This is early 30s plaster made to look like an old Spanish ceiling, and then above that, it's concrete, the concrete ceiling. And then above, sitting on the concrete ceiling, is a 3,000-gallon water tank. And then the bells and the bell tower above the water tank, okay? And that sort of serves the hilltop. Back to powerful women of Hollywood. You guys don't remember the original book and all this. Anything else, anything I haven't gotten to? You know, there are 30 antique fireplaces in the house. There are 31 fireplaces. This one, I think, is the sort of the oddball. From the other side, right, exactly.
Yeah,
right.
Yeah, we're down there.
So when you're staying in these rooms as a guest, you have the closed window side over there. You can come out this door and enjoy the open veranda out here. Last person, if you would catch that door, appreciate it.
This screen door?
No, the big brown door there. Those fruit wreaths over the windows, those are Della Robbia pieces, probably early 1500s, huh? Look at the angel candlestick holders. Those were done late 1400s or early 1500s. And it's just regular old orange clay, but it's got a tin glaze on it. And when you put
the glaze on there, it turns white, you can put a colored glaze on there, and it gives you nice bright colors, okay? This was like the big hit back in the late 1400s. This one was done, St. Joseph and the Christ Child, done by a different family, also in Florence, Italy. They just said, wow, the Della Robbias have got it, so the Bulgioni family, you know, does a similar technique here. Also, nice little piece. No, they were, the Hearst, William Randolph Hearst was an Episcopalian, at least by, you know, marriage and Catholic. tells Phoebe that she had the kid baptized because she was afraid. The kid's up and walking, he hadn't been baptized, right? She's worried about his soul. And mother's outraged, right? And then when Phoebe takes him on the big art tour of Europe when he's 10, she stops by the Vatican and has him blessed by the Pope, you know? And he gives money to Methodists and Christian Scientists, and, you know, yeah, so. It's hard, yeah. So I had somebody on tour say, like, his religion is like his art collection. A little bit of this, a little bit of that.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah. 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 Well, that
that's
cool.
That up there is part of the room. Well, that would kind of scare
me. To give you an idea, right? You know, a lot of people didn't know the art. They knew they were in rural California, and this guy has electric lights, electric heaters. He's got.
We're walking into the kitchen.
Look at the knobs.
Oh, look at that.
Are you allowed to walk around?
Yeah, come on. He's the lobster, Lee. And that tap beer.
Several things of note in here. He didn't have ice boxes. He's got Frigidaires. Huh? This is sort of state-of-the-art stuff.
Oh, yeah.
1930s, nobody's got microwave ovens, right? So he's got these warming tables that have a heating element underneath the surface here. So you turn these on and you can keep dinner warm until you're ready to sit down and eat. Huh?
That's cool.
Well, that must have been nice in the hot summer.
Yeah. In the hot summer, we just all go down to his 204-foot yacht at the harbor. These are master chefs disguised as security guards here.
Yeah. Master
chef. Chef board.
Yeah. Their master meal is plastic chicken.
Huh?
Actually, right, this is the guy that owns Good Housekeeping magazine, so that's probably why you've got a state-of-the-art kitchen. You've got electric plate warmers, electric rotisserie here, egg cooker, hooked to timers on the arms, right? So you drop the eggs into the boiling water and it pulls them out at just the right moment to eat your eggs the way you want them. When the Hearst gave the state of California this place, it came with the pots and pans and the malt shake, you know, the malt maker there, the whole thing.
Oh, big thing of cheese.
This is a very good quality fake cheese, yes. Right, staff members, first secretary, Joe Wilhelm, do lunch there.
Lee, what would you do in the kitchen this big?
Nothing.
There you go. Okay. It does smell good in here, huh?
I know.
Joe,
basketball wasn't popular yet. Good place to record.
Yep.
Big court.
This is where we came out of the other tour earlier.
This is her architecture, right, with the drafting table in here, and Hurst and Morgan go over plans for the place.
Yeah, you said they could give her a little nicer
room. Well, they literally put her in a shack.
She has a nice guest room to stay in. This is just where she's working here. And you want it to be temporary because you're going to finish the house theoretically, right? And then this comes down. This is like the...